Mr. James B. Carey is widely regarded as among the two or three principal figures in modern labor union history. He is identified with the tough school of the labor unions, and ultimately he is one of the children who was devoured by the revolution. Still, he continues as a vice president of the AFL-CIO and as secretary treasurer of the AFL-CIO industrial department, while giving most of his time to labor union matters as they bear on the United Nations. Mr. Carey was born in Philadelphia, went to high school in New Jersey, and on to the Drexel Institute. At 22, he was elected the head of a labor union. A few years later, as a head of a national labor union, he became the national secretary of the CIO in 1938. His own union, the United Electrical Union, was taken over by the communists. He fought them, and with the help of John L. Lewis, founded another electrical union, the International United Electrical Workers Union, which prospered and grew to 300,000 members, while the Communist Union shrank to a membership of 50,000. In 1965, Mr. Carey lost a union election and lost his union. We are here to examine the labor unions up against conventional notions of individual freedom. I should like to ask Mr. Carey, first of all, to tell me whether he believes it to be true that labor union members are, for the most part, members of America's middle class, so that they nowadays think of a union less as an institution to protect them from exploitation than as an institution which permits them to exploit.
Well, certainly the labor union members, by and large, believe themselves to be part of a fraternal organization that helps in solving some of the problems that confront all the people. They think of their nation before their union, and they think of the peace in the world before they think of themselves and their union and things of that nature. They believe that it's a brotherhood of man under a fatherhood of God, and that there's no likelihood that a labor organization
Come
is going
on.
To Well, I suppose you're naturally referring to the fact that I was defeated as a union officer.
Does that mean they were exploiting me?
You know that.
No, has nothing to do with it. I think as a matter of fact, it may be to your credit that you were defeated. I don't know, but I'm not passing judgment on it. I do think that labor unions are about something other than the fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man, by and large. For instance,
they need mutual aid and protection. They have to have their spokesman, just as your group does, and having you a very vigorous one. We don't have these answers for all the questions in the world that we put forth with such frequency as you do. We think that you have to have labor organizations in order to have a functioning society. We think that they ought to be free labor organizations. Now, there are differences in opinion, of course. For instance, I'm sure that I would be on the aggressive side when I think of a labor union as abolishing discrimination. I would be more aggressive than a lot of others with regards to how important it is for labor unions as such to participate in the political life of a nation, and especially in the work of the United Nations and its specialized agencies.
Yeah, but before we get into that, if I may, Mr. Carey, here's what I'd very much like to talk to you about. It seems to me that it is obvious that in any society, certain concessions are made in necessarily or unnecessarily in order to permit that society to survive. For instance, the institution of the draft at this moment is a highly contentious adaptation to, on the one hand, the necessity to have an army to protect you from external enemies, and on the other hand, to attempt to devise a system which treats everyone democratically. Now, the labor union, when it materialized, required certain concessions to the normal idea of how things ought to get done. And it's these that I'd be very much interested in your opinions about. Let's take the most example one, which is the most obvious one, which is the union shop. The traditional notions in America are that you can join an organization or not depending on whether you want to. Along comes Carey et al., and we lose this freedom. And even though it is still protected by state law in 19 states, people have moved vigorously to prevent the states even from having the right to authorize a man to join, to work without joining a union. Now, would you give me the traditional justification for the abridgment of that freedom?
Well, certainly. You're mixing several items here, like the draft, which is not exactly voluntary any more than education.
That's what I say. It's an adaptation.
All right.
Yeah.
You have here education itself is compulsory in this country. And the people that receive the benefits of a union and its efforts ought to be part of the contract, and for the duration of the agreement that they have, so it could be properly fulfilled.
Yeah, now, but suppose they don't believe there's a benefit to it.
Yeah, but just so we get it straight, this question of the right of secession was fought out in the Civil War, wasn't it?
I think we're talking about something very different.
We're talking about the strength of a union, effectiveness.
We didn't fight a civil war over the question of whether or not I had to join your electrical union.
No, not the electrical union, but there was a union in existence at the time, if you'll recall, and some thought that they ought to secede in order to preserve slavery. Now, if we have a very simple proposition, I thought that you were way past that as an argument against unionism.
I thought you were way past using such an argument. I'm not talking about the union of the.
Well, the reason you're against the union shop, that everybody belongs to the union, is because it makes it an effective union. Now, there's even American industry has pretty much accepted the fact that if they're going to deal with a union, they have to deal with an effective one. Now, the problem that we're having today is that the influence of the labor leaders is not as great as it might be. They're unable, quite frankly, to get these conditions that they negotiate accepted by the rank and file. Now, is that a bad thing or is it a good thing? Personally, I think there's too much misrepresentation about what unions are. By the way, I'm just a vice president of the AFL-CIO Emeritus.
Mm-hmm. Oh, excuse me.
And I am emeritus all these other items. Mm-hmm. So I can speak very objectively on these questions.
So I've noticed. before we get on the more general themes, Mr. Carey, let's try to just exhaust this. Is it impossible to have an effective union which is also free? I mean, which permits a minority to continue as a minority. In as much as you keep reaching for analogies, would you say that, let's say, if the majority of the United States embraces the Republican Party, there is an implicit requirement on the minority to join the Republican Party?
There's certainly no requirement to join the Republican Party.
I agree.
Wait a minute. You talked about reaching a majority, which Nixon did not reach. He got 43%. But even if he
did... I said
If they reached the majority, well, that would be over my unconscious body, at least to the best of my ability.
That's happened before, hasn't it?
Huh? Oh, certainly there have been times, but you question this business about should you give up your citizenship if your vote is not on the majority side. No, I think you ought to belong to the union. You have your point of view, you express it. A labor leader makes recommendations. He sometimes gets elected, as I usually did. I sometimes get defeated.
Mm-hmm. No, I know you think that, but I want you to justify it in terms of any standard that you want, in terms of any criterion that you want. You said to me, you're against a union shop because you don't want an effective union. Now, how do you define an effective union?
Well, a union that represents the views of the people effectively and can deal with management on a basis of equality.
Was it an effective?
Now, when you talked about the draft, You know, no, we favor this quality of sacrifice and the great number of these items that have taken place, including on a draft. You have to have some proper way to defend the nation, yes. But quite frankly, you have to also have real consideration for the views of those that are not in a majority. And you can't contend that in this country that the majority of the people that work for wages are members of unions. They're not, unfortunately. But where they do have the unions, they seek to get all the members to participate in its affairs.
No, you see, the reason I keep pressing this point is because I do believe that labor unions and the union shop cause, quote, effective unions. But by the term effective, I understand, I think, something which you will probably be a little bit uncomfortable in defending. Economists have established, for instance, that labor union members tend to get about 5 to 10% more pay than non-labor union members, but they get it from non-union workers. That is to say, it is a form of, if I may use the word, extortion. And the people who pay the labor union members are people who don't belong to the labor unions, either because they don't qualify or because they don't want to join.
What is the extortion? The fact that there's 5% of the union scale that's extorted from the non-union workers?
I'll give you, do you want an example?
Certainly.
An example would be, for instance, in New York City, where 2 or 3, 4, 5 newspapers have gone out of business during the past 10 years because the labor unions had a, quote, effective union. And the effective union said, either pay our scale or go out of business. In 4 or 5 cases, newspapers did go out of business, even newspapers that were owned by men of such vast resources as John Hay Whitney. Now, the result was that the few who survived in the union working did indeed get their 10, 15, 20, 25% raises, but a lot of other people who would otherwise have survived went from, let's say, $250 a week to welfare. Now, I call that a form of extortion. If the managers had been willing, as they were willing, to continue to operate these newspapers and to buy labor at the marketplace, a lot of people, I think, would have been better off rather than just a few.
Well, you're contending that the Herald Tribune went out of business because they paid the same wage scales as they did in the New York Times?
Absolutely. Because they weren't profitable. It's profitable. That's obvious.
Well, it certainly couldn't have been the wage scale then if the New York Times can survive with the same wage scale that was expected of the Herald Tribune.
Are you pulling my leg?
I'm not pulling your leg. I'm just telling you that there's some papers that are
National
flourishing.
Review, the National Review can't pay the same wage scale as Life magazine.
Look, John Hay Whitney, I don't think would agree with you. The reason he went out of business is because of the newspaper
he would.
Guild.
In fact, he would.
Requiring the same scale of wages in his paper as in the New York Times.
It wasn't only the same scale of wages, Mr. Carey. It was a whole series of make-work practices, setting bogus type, the kind of stuff that you spent your life devoted to. This is the kind of thing that he ran into. Now, yeah, as I say, I don't. That's why I believe.
You describe it pretty accurately as being part of the Industrial Union Department and the CIO. I was the Secretary Treasurer of the CIO. In fact, the first and only one. But we believe in industrial unions, and I refer to. I don't know that you can cite any make-work propositions with regards to the automotive industry, or the steel industry, or the rubber industry, or the electrical industry that I was associated with. So I didn't spend my life, you know, engaged in make-work propositions.
Are you prepared to disavow those unions that do? I note that the other day the Supreme Court defended...
No, not to go into it.
Defended a labor union that fined 2 machinists because they made more of their machines than they were told by the union they were permitted to make during 8 hours because they wanted a little extra money. So they were fined by the union, i.e. the union specifically didn't want them to exercise themselves in productivity. And this now all of a sudden creeps into respectability via the Supreme Court, which does suggest a revolution in traditional notions about human freedom, doesn't it?
Well, as the Supreme Court did rule that the member of the unions have to comport themselves according to the rules that these members themselves determine. Now, there are such a thing as people just working too much overtime or working beyond their quota and doing that. And
why?
What?
Why? I say why. If you want to work for 8 hours
runs
a day
into the question.
And you happen to be a very good bricklayer and you make 350 bricks while I only make 300, why should I keep you from doing so? Or is this required in the name of an effective union?
Well, let's go back to the original proposition. Mm-hmm. Where you're talking about in mass production operations.
I don't know it was mass production. It might have been a small shop, for all I know.
Oh, no, it was a very large shop.
Does it matter?
Very large corporation. It's interesting that when they have an agreement on the basis of the production standards, now we talk about if I'm a very good bricklayer and if I want to work 12 hours a day and put two people out of work in the course of doing it, that may not be a sound proposition. Now, how about getting on to the point? If you're concerned about restrictive activities, make sure that you're doing that in an atmosphere where everyone has at least an opportunity for employment in that field. Now, many of the restrictive activities, which I don't happen to approve of, are because we have too many people for the amount of jobs available in that particular field. And so they share the opportunities among them. Now, is there anything that's violates the brotherhood of man in that regard, or?
Oh yes, quite a bit.
Now, wait a minute, you're
in the first place.
You're talking about the brotherhood of man, not free enterprise, okay. Or your idea of what management.
I think you're afraid for me to answer that question.
No, you go right ahead and you answer it.
Well, in the first place, I don't remember that what happened in New York was that the people who survived the strike split up their jobs and simply took, say, 20-hour jobs per week in order to give employment to those who did not survive the strike. In fact, you know, and I know, it didn't happen. They took it all. They took the 40-hour week, and they took raises, and they opposed automation, and they insisted on setting bogus type, with the result that there was more unemployment after the strike than there was before the strike. There goes that particular piece of hypocrisy of a lot of labor union leaders, point one. Point two, if your notion is an increase in efficiency is going to cause unemployment, then the only answer is to become a Luddite, go out and break all of the machines, as they attempted to do in the early part of the 19th century. And there's a sense in which some labor union theorists seem to be driven towards that position, don't you think?
Well, I don't know of any.
Don't you?
But you might know of some. That they're driven towards that. All I'm saying to
you
is you might reduce the number of hours, you see. Now, let's just take the fact that we got a lot of people in this audience and ought to have some opportunity for employment when they get out. Now, I suppose we're working too many hours to provide an opportunity for other people to get employment.
If you're working a great many hours,
I think it would be a good thing for the labor unions to be more aggressive than they have been in bringing about full employment and maintaining full employment. And where American industry is unable or unwilling to provide jobs for all that are seeking the jobs, at decent standards too, then the government will have to do something about it.
Now, well, that is an ancient position or superstition. In any
event, it's not breaking up the machinery like the Luddites, is it?
Okay, no, but you have to remember that if somebody works an extra 4 hours per day, let's say, what happens is that he earns extra money. Now, that money is of no use to him unless he spends it. And if he spends it, he is creating a demand which will put more people to work. So people who work long hours create jobs rather than the contrary. You do understand?
Well, we would prefer to have the wages for a reasonable work day increased so that they don't have to put somebody else out of a job in order to operate at a higher standard of living. Now, I'm saying it's all fine if everybody's employed. then you don't have to be concerned about restrictions on work practices. You don't have to be concerned about somebody working too hard, or you don't have to be concerned about them working too many hours. All I'm saying is, in all justice, can we see that it was not some vendetta against Jay Whitney, you know, that they put the Herald Tribune out of business? I don't think it had very much to do with the comparable labor conditions that existed. I don't think it had much to do with the work practices. Now, we're engaged in a process here, and I was part of it before I got on your show, and I work a little thing like television. Now, television may have taken some of the importance away from the newspapers, including the Herald Tribune. They might have even taken some of the advertising, and they might have made it a little bit more difficult. But I'm not saying that we ought to do away with television to protect J. Hayes Whitney or the Herald Tribune. I would say that these are natural developments. Yeah, well,
you're not denying that there has been a considerable resistance by organized labor to automation, to improve technology, to,
and
for
not
instance,
by
the setting of type.
Recently deceased John L. Lewis, mm-hmm. He was, in fact, in my opinion.
And he was a very interesting exception.
Oh, he was not an exception by any means. You don't, he was, I thought, he could have taken more precautions about the safety of the miners when they're producing at such a high rate in terms of coal dust and things of that nature. But we had technical advances. They could have preserved the lives of a lot of the people. I think they were late in the introduction of them, and they're far short of it now. So I would say that, as an example, you say, well, now that John L. Lewis has passed away, and he was in favor of automation, and John L. Lewis believed and carried it out. Instead of having a million or so, you know, working at too low a rate of pay, mm-hmm. that we'd have half of them and take some care of the others at, in the you know, marginal mines.
Mr. Carey, again, I want to return, if I may, to your use of the word effective, because it does seem to me that American society has shown itself willing during the past 20, 30 years to grant a whole long string of immunities to labor unions from traditionally proscribed behavior as a result of the fact that somebody somewhere along the line convinced us that it is more important to have effective unions than to have traditional American freedoms. Now, for a moment, I won't argue with this or not, but I would like to get inside this question. An example, I think, would be the vice president of General Motors, who a few years ago observed that if 5 million people per year ordered black stick shift Cadillacs, General Motors could produce them and sell them at a profit for $1,700 a piece, which certainly suggests that the cost of freedom is very high, right? But nevertheless, we make certain concessions in behalf of that kind of diversity and in order to allow people to choose other cars than Cadillacs, if only because we think that strategically this will end us up in a dynamic, with a dynamic economy. Now, the labor union, just to begin with, wiped away the whole idea of anti-monopoly, right? There's nothing wrong with a monopoly labor union, is there?
There's no such thing as a monopoly labor union.
To quote a famous phrase, you devoted your life to creating a monopoly.
No, just a minute. To quote a famous phrase, I guess I was up against some of the toughest monopolies in this country, and...
Like what?
Like General Electric.
They have no competitors? What happened to Westinghouse?
They're buddies, they're cousins. And Westinghouse, they were involved in this lawsuit too, you mm-hmm. see.
Yeah,
29 of these companies.
They can be taken to jail,
so,
can't they?
Yeah, they were. They were taken to
okay,
jail.
Okay, well, that's good, isn't it?
Just a minute.
That's good.
And
We're in favor of monopolists going to jail?
They're put in jail for 25 days.
Well, that's
now, you put a group like that in the same cell block together for 25 days, they're going to fix prices for years to come. Well, no, don't tell me. Now, the reason they got 25 days is because they had 5 days off for good behavior. They had no other choice, actually, right at that particular time.
Well, Did you criticize the Democratic administration for failure to prosecute the laws?
Again, for price fixing?
Yeah.
Oh, I tried to encourage them to prosecute the laws.
Why didn't they?
That's why these fellas went to jail for 25 days.
Why didn't you ask
under
Congress,
very fine conditions, by the
why
way.
Why didn't you ask Congress to make stiffer penalties? But look.
Oh, we did.
Let's not talk about the administration
of
the law. Let's talk about the existence of the law.
And they were given fines, you see. Mm-hmm. These great men of industry. And then they made those fines tax deductible. Now, actually,
it is a business expense, isn't it?
Pardon? Well, yeah, I don't know about these immunities that labor leaders get. When I was ever fined, I didn't make it. It wasn't tax deductible, that's for sure.
No, some union paid it for you.
What?
Some union paid it
Certainly
for you.
Certainly did not.
Well, that's true.
They didn't pay the fine against John L. Lewis. One against the union, one against the man, but...
Albert Shanker had to keep people in line to pay his fines for him here in New York. It was sort of first come, first served. They drew lottery for the privilege. Will you agree on this point, that however badly administered the anti-monopoly laws are, at least they exist, and some people have gone to jail for it, whereas there is, in the law books, a specific immunity that extends to labor unions. That is, the labor unions or may conspire together, and in doing so, they are not to be held in restraint of trade.
No, they just
aren't
decided
you embarrassed about that?
It's not a conspiracy to belong to a labor union or for labor unions to work together. And I'm not certainly not embarrassed. Now, I think it's not a conspiracy. Now, we don't.
We don't carry on a campaign
against the National Association of Manufacturers or the Chamber of Commerce. I never heard of an employer that was fired because he belonged to the Chamber of Commerce. But I have heard of labor union leaders that were fired. I heard them that were...
You're shifting the grounds of the discussion.
Oh,
I don't
blame
you.
I'm talking right directly to the point now.
I think people are going to lose their faith in your credibility if you're going to say there's no difference between the law the monopoly law as regards labor unions and as regards industry, because everybody who's gone past the ninth grade knows that there is, you see. Now, you're not going to deny this, are you? The laws of the United States say that you can't prosecute a labor union under the restraint for being in restraint of trade if it seeks to build up an organization coast to coast which embraces all of the people who work for a particular industry.
Well, there's a few labor leaders that are now serving time, you know.
For what?
Well, for the same
violation. For stealing, sure.
They serve time for other things, too. Not paying their income tax. They serve times for corruption and taking bribes. And they serve time for a lot of other things. No, I don't think there are these immunities. I'll tell you this. I'm always surprised that following a war that labor participates in fully in behalf of the country, like World War II, we got, of course, Taft-Hartley, and then in the Korean conflict, we got Landon Griffin. I don't know what's going to come out of this present one, but the Chamber of Commerce is working like the devil to work up a whole new
That's interesting.
Bunch of restrictions.
In other words, you then agree that two major pieces of legislation were passed whose attempt was to repeal some of the extraordinary immunities and privileges of the labor unions, which means that they must have been there to repeal in the first instance.
I'm not talking about... I'm talking now about, some of the impositions of these laws may be unsound and unworkable.
Mm-hmm.
But there are conditions that build up in the course of, military hostilities in which we're not able to get grievances resolved and things of that nature. And so unrest builds up. Mm-hmm. And then following the unrest, sometimes they explode, not to the extent they explode on the campuses of this country, but and other countries, but they explode and you can't get the grievance settled fast enough. So then Congress gets working with the Chamber of Commerce and the NAM and influences like yourself to propose a whole new group of restrictions. Now, we're not talking about that these are immunities. It's just the fact that we have some serious problems, and I don't think that the people in the United States are overpaid by a long sight. I think maybe they're working too many hours considering their, you know, the developments in technical ability in order to provide minorities with at least a chance for employment. I think there does have to be, there will have to be some sharing. There had to be some elimination in some unions, a few, that still practice a restrictive arrangement with regards to people of different races or different nationalities. In fact, there are some crafts where it's, you almost have to be the son of a same kind of worker in order to get a job.
Yes, I began by making that allusion. Mr. Carey, the as I understand it, you see what's happening in America as a sort of a continuing attempt to adjust so as to integrate the labor unions to a point where they are in some sort of a constitutional equilibrium with other main forces in this country, and I understand this point. I know, for instance, that over the turn of the century, it was widely agreed by almost everybody that a business had become too powerful. Business monopolies, particularly, were buying and selling whole states and legislation and the rest of it. What then happened was a lot of legislation which was passed in order to control them. The difference between the situation then and the situation now is that labor unions have control of votes, individual votes, and under the circumstances, they can still get people like Lyndon Johnson to jump through their hoop, as he did when he called on Congress to repeal provision 14B of the Taft-Hartley law, even after he had denounced it while he was a member of the Senate. But we now get a sense of motion. Now, what are you going to do, or what is your position about the fact that labor unions are uniquely not subject to taxation? Would you like a change there so that they'd have to pay taxes like other people?
Well, we do pay taxes like other people, and I think for anything that's engaged, the union is engaged in, such as enterprise or owning a real estate and things of that nature, ought to be taxable,
well,
just like it should be with any other group. Now, don't
what
think
about
of a labor union
taxation,
as being like a corporation. You know, that it's interested in making a profit as such, and that should be taxed. And what we tax in this country, of course, is increment and income. And those things are taxable.
Well, what about money that goes into a labor union in the same sense that, for instance, money goes into an organization of pharmacists? Ought that to be taxed as income to the organization or not?
A pharmacist engaged in a competitive operation? I would say certainly.
Well, it depends. It depends. If they have publications and so on and so forth, they often.
Oh, those things should be taxed.
They should be taxed, all right.
All right, now, you asked earlier, you know, about this union shop business.
Yes, sir.
And, of course, you know about the American Medical Association. You know about the
American
Bar Association.
I don't know that you have to join it to practice medicine, do you?
Oh, no. You just didn't have to have any patients, or to be able to get a patient in a hospital, you have to be a member of the American Medical Association.
Is that true?
Oh, sure, and well, I think you know it.
But we should be against that, shouldn't we?
Hmm?
We should be against that, shouldn't we? Why hasn't the Democratic
Congress
done anything
about it? Well, I think you ought to be as much against that as you are against the labor organization having a union shop.
I agree. Yeah?
I think you ought to be. Now, you know that you have to be a member of the American Bar Association to appear in a court, don't you?
In that case, you are against the union shop.
Pardon? I didn't say that.
I thought you said that you would be against
it. No, I might be against it for the American Medical Association in certain communities. where they discriminate against all the people having equal access to the facilities. I may be against situations like that, even on part of labor unions, where they might be against membership. But I'm not in favor of a, you know, complete membership. I'm not opposed to having a complete membership.
I'm not challenging your right to be idiosyncratic. I'm only challenging your pretensions not to being idiosyncratic when in fact you
just want to challenge your right to be so awfully one-sided that you can only see evil when a labor union does it, but you don't even know that the American Medical Association or the American Bar Association does it. Certainly it's legal.
I didn't, and I always assume that I'd be reminded of these things by Democratic administrations. But I've been to lots of Democratic conventions, I've heard lots of labor unions, and I haven't heard that particular point made as something that needs instant legislative attention.
Well, you talked about President Johnson recommending repeal of 14B, and that we asked him to do that. Some of us had asked him to repeal the whole Landrum-Griffin and opposed it from the very beginning. We wouldn't settle for 14B of Taft-Hartley. In fact, you're speaking to someone who was not only in favor of repealing the legislation, but we were in favor of removing the sponsors of it as well.
Of course, I'm in favor too. I'd go so far as to want to repeal the Wagner Act.
Oh, well, we're not talking about a local legislation. We're talking about federal legislation.
Well, I'm talking about federal legislation.
Oh, I thought maybe you were talking about something here in New York.
No, the big one.
The big item about
the Norris LaGuardia Act I'd repeal tomorrow.
Well, but you should know about the Wagner Act. It's been pretty much changed. It's called Taft-Hartley Act. And then it's been Landrum-Griffin
Act. It's called the National Labor Relations Act as amended.
I don't know what the next one will be, but I'll say this.
Freedom Act.
But 14B is still a law of the land, despite our political influence.
Yes, sir.
And if we had the influence politically that you suggest, you don't think 14B would be part of the law of the land, do you?
No, you don't have quite the influence that you would like to have, for which I am grateful. But you have a considerable amount of influence. There are only 19 states in which you can work without joining a particular labor union. This isn't one of them. That is to say, you can't work in a number of enterprises.
I don't quite get your point. Now, it is true that Senator Johnson voted for this law, and when he was president, he wanted to repeal a small portion of it. And you said that we made him do that? We didn't him do it in either case. I wish he hadn't voted for it. It'd have been a much better senator if he had not voted for it.
Well, of course.
But if the majority of Congress can be brought about to repeal some of these things, I think they should. I don't think they should go around thinking that everything is nice and rosy in the mines and the mills and the factories. The conditions are not too good, and the wages are much too low to support our kind of mass production economy.
Yeah, well,
and I'm not thinking in terms of the Cadillacs that could be made if the people were able to buy them. I'm just thinking about decent home. Yeah. Pardon?
Why not? I mean, most Americans desire a car, want a car. It'd be nice if they have a good car for $1,500, $1,600. But the answer is we know.
Well, you're talking about a good car.
A Cadillac.
I'm talking about the kind you can buy today. No, they're not too good. And they're not worth what they're charged for.
It's
not due to the labor cost. We got a problem here.
Mr. Carey, we can spend a lot of time, and I'd be glad to do it if you really want, deploring the take-home income of a lot of families in America, and I do. But the most recent poll that I saw conducted by a labor union, in fact, was suppressed because the labor union simply didn't want this kind of information to have been got out. You know what the number one complaint was? It wasn't that they wanted more fringe benefits or more this or more that. It was taxes. And all of a sudden, the working man has discovered that one of the reasons why all of these gains that the labor unions and other people have got for him aren't meaning very much is because they're paying very high taxes and because there's inflation. Now, this is something that is the unfortunate result of public policies which, on the whole, have been backed by labor union leaders, right? It is kind of sad, isn't it?
And what are you referring to? The most important proposition as far as contributing to inflation, of course, is our defense effort.
No,
and the amount that we're spending in Southeast Asia.
You know, I'd like to be able to go along with that. But
I wish
I
could. You talk
you know
to you a little bit about what contributes to inflation.
Because we've had more inflation in non-war situations. We had plenty of inflation under Truman, much more, in fact, than we have had just now under Johnson. It is true that it tends to go hand in hand with Democratic administration. We had most of all under Roosevelt.
Well, you say it, but that doesn't make it so.
I'm just telling you how it is.
You know,
saying, for instance, we had very little under Eisenhower. Very little.
Pardon?
Very little under Eisenhower. Practically
well, we're talking now about under Nixon, aren't we?
Nixon's only been in office 2 months.
He's been in office more than two months. It only seems like two months to you.
Well, I'm glad to hear it seems like longer to some of the rest of us.
It's a situation in which certainly, even if it was only 2 months, you'd expect that he would have accomplished one thing.
What?
One item.
What?
Just a simple
stopping inflation?
Well, stopping the Vietnam War, for one. He said he was going to do it.
I'm not going to fight the Vietnam War with you no
matter
how
Oh, you don't have to fight it with me. There's plenty of other opportunity.
I hope you're not seriously contending.
I'm seriously suggesting to you that Nixon has been in, and we have inflation now. And we, in fact, we're having more of it in terms of as against the previous administration that you referred to. But here we have a situation of where I would certainly expect a little more than we've been getting.
Well, what?
Now, you tell me that the people are complaining about the amount of taxes they're paying.
Yeah, I don't blame them.
I don't blame them either. Yeah. They're paying a tremendous amount of our national's resources are going to efforts that are wasteful to the
because we had to fight the communists. How much money did you spend fighting the communists and the labor unions?
Well, it was our money, and we fought them.
But you fought,
that's
well,
right.
It was also the money of people who had to join your union in order to practice electricity.
Pardon?
It was also the money of people who had to join your union or another union in order to practice their trade.
When we fought the communists, you know what I mean? I was not in office. I was, you know, had been defeated.
Yeah.
And then we raised our funds largely by my writings.
Yeah, but I mean, my point is, if you have to fight communists, how come America doesn't have to fight communists? You understand what the experience is like.
I'm just simply saying that is where most of the money that contributes to the inflation in this country goes to.
But what caused the inflation of the 1940s, late 1940s, when we weren't fighting a war? Or the 30s when we weren't fighting a war?
You didn't hear about Korea? You didn't hear about the defense expenditures in this country?
Korea was not until 1950.
Wait a minute. All right.
June 1950.
I was talking about
I'm talking
large
about the inflation of 46, 47, 48, 49.
That we make in this country, not for a specific
war. What war did we fight in the 30s?
Pardon?
What war did we fight in the 30s?
Well, I was involved
in a heavy
depression. We had
42% inflation.
And, pardon?
42% inflation.
In the 30s?
Yes, sir.
And you think that was whose fault?
Okay, no.
Huh?
Mr. Greenfield.
Yeah, I've had some difficulty following the course of this discussion.
I have too, yeah.
on both sides. So I just think that two facts, and they may be trivial, but I can't tell after this discussion. That poll of labor unions, in fact, was published ultimately in a labor union magazine, at least that's where I read it. But taxes
Speaked
were
out.
Complaints.
Yeah.
No, it was Leaked. Labor magazine. Yeah. Also, as I recall in the Eisenhower administration, while inflation may have slowed, we had two things. We had the largest peacetime deficit in history before the Vietnam War, and we also had two recessions, which threw several million people out of work. My question, if I might, is directed to Mr. Carey, and that is that your complaint about, or your suggestion as to what might be done to bring more people into unions strikes me as a little bit odd, because at least in New York, we've had no end of trouble of getting people into a lot of the craft unions. The cost of, for instance, construction in New York is awesomely risen in the last 5 years. And there have been some suggestions, not by Mr. Buckley's conservatives, but by quite different kinds of people ideologically, that the reason is that just as the AMA is keeping the supply of doctors artificially low to raise their own wages, labor unions are engaged in precisely that same form of venture. That, for instance, the same way one has group medical insurance now, where people do not belong to the AMA, one might consider having a new kind of outfit, constructing low-cost housing through technology, which craft unions now don't let occur because of their rules. Do you think that's a good idea?
Mr. Greenfield, my remark was that I don't spend all my time or all my life creating these devices.
I wasn't
in fact,
that.
I spent a large part of my life opposing these practices by unions or by anybody else. I make it very clear. I think they are anti-union to have such obstacles presented. I make no bones about it. The discrimination against people by reason of race or sex or nationality or something like that. I do know that part of it is for the purpose that you suggested, that they don't want to be flooded with people who'll come in and work at lower wage standards and just drive them back to nothing again. Now, of course, there's a lot of our discussion that might not be clearly understood. I would like some time to get a word in for Mr. Shanker and some of the other teachers that certainly do not have a monopoly on teaching, and they certainly are not responsible for some of the campus uprisings that have taken place throughout the country. I think organization of teachers is coming awfully late. As to how you bring people into the unions, I think that the unions ought to be open. And when you become a member of the union, you become a full member, full participating member.
What
and
you want
pay
to be
the dues and you participate. I don't believe in this halfway business. And for the duration of the contract, I think they ought to be members of the union. So that's how I believe.
Ms. Fitzgerald.
It's interesting if you think one might become a half citizen of the United States.
I think a lot of people are, don't you?
Well, you speak of. But also,
Present company, excuse me.
But you seem to be implying before in your speech that industry has somehow become feeble and weak and helpless and faced by the labor union. Was that? Do I understand you right, or do you not think that?
That industry has become what?
Sort of weak and helpless by comparison to the labor unions.
She suggested we might give a care package to Jay Whitney. What's her name?
Well, I'm certainly glad that nobody in this room has to pay the $14 or $15 million that he spent sustaining the Herald Tribune, which he would not have had to sustain if he'd been able to go to the free market to get some of Mr. Greenfield's unemployed people and put them to work without causing some sort of a labor union war.
Well, I have to agree with you on that case. I just wonder whether this is generally the case.
No, well, let me try to understand your question directly. I do think that a lot of people go out of business. A lot of firms go out of business because they cannot meet costs which are artificially stipulated.
You think there are some rules that are ordained that...
Free market.
Well, I thought your earlier point was that because the Herald Tribune was paying the same rates of pay for the same type of work as the New York Times, that's the reason they went out.
It is. It is.
That's the reason they went out of business.
Correct.
You mean that the Herald Tribune had to pay less than somebody else to stay in business?
Correct. Because they couldn't compete.
They had less income,
Less income, yeah.
Fairly simple proposition.
No, but that's not the reason. The reason is they didn't get enough advertising. They paid high enough for that. Now, they didn't have enough readers or something like that. It's not because they...
This is really a let them eat cake.
Anyway, my heart is broken over the fact that somebody is not permitted to pay less than every other newspaper pays for the same type of work.
Mr. Coyne.
Mr. Carey, could we return to the field of your competence for a moment? I'd like to, it seems to me that a few decades ago, bright young men were fighting to get into trade unions. This, in many ways, probably was the best thing that could ever happen to them. Today, bright young men go to state universities. Do you find this tendency has an effect upon the quality of the people you can get, say, 4 apprenticeships and therefore the quality of work that the trade unions are putting out?
Well, I have a notion that I'd like to see a lot more young people look towards labor organizations for positions of leadership as and for a great number of other reasons. But the standards in American industry today about the educational qualifications are so great now, it's beyond almost any reason. It's not easy to get at a position with a big corporation, for instance, unless you have had a college training.
Well, is it tough to get good apprentices?
Well, it's tough to get good apprentices, yes. But I don't think there is enough done in vocational training, either by the schools or by the communities or by the unions and by the employers. Hmm. Employers are a little reluctant to train people that may work for some other employer.
As are the universities.
Pardon?
Thank you very much, Mr. Carey. Thank you all very much. Come back. Thank you. Now that you're a full-time member.